Thank you, Mr. Peterson. Ladies and gentlemen, we came here to Washington on Monday, and we meet a lot of people, and mainly we discuss what will happen in Russia after a new president is there from day before yesterday. And all economists overestimate the importance of economic life and economic consideration, but let me remind you that all change of political change in the Soviet Union in the end of 80s, the main reason for that was not ideas of Mr. Gorbachev, his desires or whatever. The main reason was economic problems of the Soviet Union, which arose from the collapse of the oil price in 1985. As a junior economist, I used to work for Gorbachev, and I am pretty sure that in 85, when he took power, he had no intention to destroy Soviet Union, in principle, not to change seriously the system. But it became, on a certain stage, unavoidable just because budgetary constraints was too hard and he had to do something. So the fact of when we now discuss what might happen in Russia, first of all, we have to think what will be the future of Russian economy, which challenges it will face, and what problems may arise. So in fact, what I will tell, I will try to present our vision, what was achievements and what was the results of 8 years of Mr. Putin in office, what are main challenges which Russia now face, and then we'll be prepared together with Michael Friedman to answer all your possible questions. I hope that Michael will answer most dangerous political and business-oriented questions, and I will stay with the economy. So let me start just purely from figures. What shall I push to start? Oh, it's okay. If you look on fundamentals, what's the usual start of any discussion about economic life, especially when all major figures for Russian economy starting from 2000, the year when Putin started his presidency, you can see that all fundamentals are extremely strong. Russia has a very stable and high growth rate. This year we expect it's above 8%. Russia has enormous reserves. When I was appointed Russian Foreign Economic Relations Minister in November 11, 1991, and I was responsible for hard currency reserves, the figure which we had was $60 million US dollars. It was one third of day's import. Today, only reserves of the central bank is close to $500 billion. Plus, we have almost $200 billion in stabilization fund, which is about 15% of the GDP. So this is a completely different story. Russia has still have current account surplus. It's about 6% of GDP. It's going down, but anyway, it's still high. And the only figure which is from all these pictures, which may be dangerous, is inflation, which is, as we discuss it later on, but inflation is now going up, and the official figure, which is an Alpha Bank projection, is 11.5%, but I strongly believe that it'll be above 12%, whatever they do. If we go on further on, and just to compare where Russia was in 2000 and where it is in 2007, we can see that macroeconomically Russia was definitely very successful. If you compare Russia with all its peers, you can see that Russia, even in 1990, Russia had relatively high growth rate, close to 7%, but with 8%, Russia will be better off than, at average, all these major countries with whom we compete. That's starting from countries who came from communist economies like Czech Republic, Hungary, or Poland, and then India, Ukraine, or whoever you take into account. In fact, private wealth in Russia, especially private wealth in Russia, increased seriously faster than in peers, and Russia has received investment grade, which is also very important. And you see it on the picture on the right, you can see that from the viewpoint of real disposable incomes, Russia is better off than anybody else in the country. In fact, real disposable incomes grew 140% during the last 7 years of Mr. Yeltsin. And that's, in fact, that's the main explanation for sure why Putin is so popular. When average growth rate of real incomes is above 10% a year, it's very difficult to be unpopular. that's, well, I'm an economist, so I believe in figures, so that's you can, but you can see. So still you can see that Kazakhstan, for example, and Ukraine also very successful, but in major principle macroeconomic indicators, Russia was better off than anybody else. If you come back again to, people usually forget the past very soon. But if you just look back, we can see that in 2000, in year 2000, Russia had growth which was completely correlated with oil price. 17% of population were employed by the state, and Russia was had very strong budget deficit, very stable budget deficit during 95-2000. A very high state debt. In fact, Russian foreign state debt was equal to 50% of GDP when Yeltsin took office. So macroeconomically, it was absolutely different picture, and Russia was recovering from 1998 crisis. So in fact, all this economic situation didn't look so favorable. We had capital flight, and it was one of the main topic in press. And all accusations toward Russian oligarchs that all money are taken outside the country. You can see it here. And de facto, capital flight was estimated around up to 20%, $20 billion a year before 2000. We had no FDI, and in spite of the very low salary, which was $79 a month was average salary. Now it's around $550, by the way. Not 79, that's a huge change. We had almost had no banking sector de facto in that time, no FDI, and also all these figures show that macroeconomically, again, country was very, very, very weak. We had serious social problems. The main problem was housing, of course. I'll discuss it maybe in more detail, but in Russia in that time was 20 square meters per person, and 50% of the population lived on less than $4 a day in 1999. So de facto, Russia in that time was a very poor country. And in fact, all dynamics of Gini coefficient, what any indicators of inequalities were going up and down. And nobody believed in ruble. And in fact, we had all deposits de facto in 2000 were only in hard currency. And in principle, deposit to GDP ratio was too low, but in fact, all these deposits were also in dollars. We had famous saying, de facto ruble was not regarded a reliable currency at all. We had a famous saying of our former Deputy Prime Minister Alfred Koch, who loved to come to New York and spend holidays in US. And when he was asked why you go to US, not to Europe, he said, US is much more convenient, they use our money. So, and that was exactly the case, the no confidence in ruble. So that's how it was. And in fact, that's a list of reforms. In that time, I used to give more lectures than now, but that was in 2000. I tried to, that's exactly for my presentation which was done in year 2000. What reforms Russia needed in that time. And all these reforms were absolutely obvious. Russia had to decrease seriously total budget expenditures. And in fact, that was, in Soviet Union and in Russia at that time, it was about 35% of GDP. They collected and spent more or less the same. There was no idea about stabilization fund, though the oil prices started to grow after 2000. They definitely need a crucial tax reform, because at that time tax collection was very, very poor, and tax burden formally was very high. Russia had no pension system. I will tell later on what we have now, but that was the list for 2000. Russia de facto didn't have in the banking sector deposit insurance. We had 4,000 banks in that time. We had almost no foreign banks in the country. Russia was completely overregulated, and in that time, official figure was that 10% of GDP was produced by small and medium-sized enterprises. In that time, already figure for Central Europe was around 50%, and exact figure for United States, I guess it's about 60%, something like that, it has to be. And SME employed about 15% of the labor force only. Cross-subsidization in Russian industry was above 5% of GDP, and in fact, all price orients were completely distorted. And you can see also that was, it could be felt in everyday life as number of residential and communal housing had increased by 5 times since 1990. So de facto, it was strong feeling that something was going very, very wrong. And that was a major thing which de facto is when Putin came in, I guess this feeling was very deep in his head. Also, we can see that de facto fixed investment, as percentage of GDP in the second half of the 90s, permanently were going down. Energy efficiency was very bad, and so on and so forth. Now, if we compare where we are now with what we had before, that's a very clear, and in fact, that's self-explaining slide. You can see that the federal budget, which was 1.5% surplus in 2000, but it was the first years of surplus. Before that, it was all deficit. Instead of 1.5%, it's 5.5%. It's very stable, in fact. Central bank reserves from, it already was not 60 million, but 28 billion. In 2000, but now it's 476 in the end of the year. You can see that foreign debt now is completely covered by state reserves. There's not only state debt, it's all types of debt. De facto state foreign debt is only 3.6% of GDP. It's one of the lowest figures in the world now. And instead of net capital flow, outflows, here's the figure for 2025 billion. We have capital inflows, which was estimated for last year, $81 billion. So I guess that's, this picture doesn't need any comment. We'll discuss what's the role of oil price for that, but in fact, macroeconomically, it's very obvious figures. Russia is in a very stable, extremely sustainable macroeconomic situation now. In fact, next figures just can prove it. And in fact, private consumption rose dramatically in the country. Investment growth accelerated. Unemployment went down, and today's figure is about 6% instead of we had 9% when Putin came in. Serious capital utilization grew up from about 50% of industry up to almost 90% today. And again, from the budgetary viewpoint, if you now compare Russia with peers, we can see that from budgetary situation, Russia is definitely, again, better off than all major countries. In fact, that's just continuation of the same slide. And again, some factor of stability is that only Russia and China are running both capital and current account surplus during recent years. And in fact, fortunately, Russia, and that's definitely Putin deserves all our gratitude. Russia, instead of spending stabilization fund money, Russia was used this money to pay foreign debt, that's number one, and to increase level of living somehow, and then to build strong reserves. And that definitely is a result of all these years. You can see that on the right picture, that's information about which shows the stabilization fund, state foreign debt, and today that's again, there's absolutely no threat from, in 1998, that's the crisis was a debt crisis, domestic and foreign debt crisis. And Russia was the one of, as far as I remember, the only example of world peaceful history where the country simultaneously defaulted on domestic and foreign debt. But today, just to imagine anything like that is absolutely impossible. To be frank, all the emerging markets, we discussed with John Orlin Smee just before the lecture what was positive in IMF involvement in Russia's life. I guess that one very important thing which IMF did, not only to Russia but to everybody, that everybody had to learn the lesson that you need much more reliable budgetary policy. And what Russians really understood that budgetary surplus is a must. And whatever happened, and the Russians understood it even better than the rest of the world, so the whole all situation with current account, with fiscal situation definitely is better not only in Russia but in other emerging market countries. But Russia, again, from macroeconomic viewpoint, Russia is among leaders even in this group. And you can see that emerging markets now have a current surplus instead of deficit in the beginning of 90s, and all countries used foreign debt. But anyway, Russia is, again, macroeconomically much more stable than anybody else. That's what's very important about social issues. We always discussed, again, popularity of Putin. Russians are definitely much better off on average than they were 10 years ago. And that you can see not only in Moscow. In Moscow, that's a real boom. But de facto, you can see it all science. In fact, a number of cars is triple. That's from 1991. De facto, that's I saw the latest figure. The number of sold cars tripled during the last 7 years of Putin's presidency. And there you can see that Moscow, that's a problem for those who live in Moscow. But it's we had the Secretary Rumsfeld who gave a lecture for Alpha on some of Alpha Bank occasion. And he said that the problem is not that so many cars in Moscow. That's the problem that all around my hotel. And that's absolutely the point. But de facto, number of cars increased dramatically. Living conditions, whatever you measure, is absolutely new life. Russia had the first revolution in housing after Khrushchev came here in the end of 50s, you know. And after that, in Russia, he was shocked by housing. After that, in the Soviet Union, we started to, in all in my generation, they started to build apartments. Before that, it was communal apartments, 8 families with one toilet, and that's how it was. But it was one revolution. The second revolution housing took place now, during the last 5-10 years of Putin. That's a real revolution. Normal houses, normal living conditions, and de facto there's no figures here, but a number of square meters built doubled during the last 2 years. So now we build at 60 million square meters built in housing every year. That's a big figure. It's absolutely new life. It's also here you can see that 10 million Russians travel abroad. I would suspect that the number for US is less. Just because for Russians, ability to travel is something very special. It was impossible before end of 80s. But that also shows that level of consumption. And we have number of students which doubled. And more than what was the most important, when I was, a student, we were told that the major and general characteristic of quality of life is infant mortality. Infant mortality in the Soviet Union in the end of the period was 17 per thousand. Now it's 11 in Russia, which was difficult to imagine in our time. So I will tell about weakness of Russian medicine. But anyway, birth rate has increased from 1995. And infant mortality went down, is going down, in spite of many problems with healthcare, which we still face in the country. So de facto, absolute majority of population, definitely living conditions purely, is definitely much better off now than they were 7 years ago. And that's whatever, and we discussed it many times with our American colleagues, definitely for a poor country, after 70 years of very poor life, and very abnormal living conditions, all this change guarantees popularity of any leader. That's by far the most important factor. And I think that all these discussions about civil rights, press, and for popularity of a leader is definitely marginal compared to these figures. And these figures are absolutely obvious. Of course, that's not so simple. On the one hand, you can see that real disposable income was going up 10% a year, 10, 12% a year. And in fact, that's not only, that came from GDP growth, but plus the absolutely new products on the market, for example, consumer loans. In 2000, they were not existent at all. And that was unknown. Mortgages are still almost unknown product in the big part of the city. But consumer loans, now 28% of Russians have at least one consumer loan. 12 years ago, I had British nanny with my kids in Moscow. And when she came, she loved Moscow immediately, and she wanted to buy something, she wanted to stay. And she asked me, what about mortgages? And I said that mortgages in this country do not exist. And she said the sentence which I always remember, she said, mortgage is a civil right. believe me that this civil right, which was not existent, and civil right to obtain a loan, that's absolutely changed the general life for absolutely majority of population. At the same time, you can see on the right picture, that's what's called avoidable mortality. there's a number of people which could survive but died from the disease which could be cured but were not saved. That we see negative dynamics. And that's a reflection of very poor healthcare system. In England, it was close to England, where it's not also, my family is in England, that's not the best medicine in the world, I would say. But you can see that if you compare again Soviet Union and Russia, they were more or less on the same level 20 years ago. It's complete change now. England improved its medicine, Russian avoidable mortality rate went up. And that's one thing. And the second thing, which is the most important thing, is pensioners. Due to demographic changes, now in the 2000, 22% of Russians received and had a state pension as the main source of their income. Today the figure is 27%. It's 40 million people. And all these 40 million people, absolute majority of these 40 million people, they just purely receive pension from the state pension fund. Private pension system, I will come back to that, was not created. Today, in the Soviet Union, for many years, average ratio, pension to salary ratio, stayed at the level of 40%. In fact, it was 38% in 1999. It now went to 26% and further going down. So when we say that Russians are better off, I would say Russians, but not pensioners. So that's a big group of people, mainly older generation, who are out of their reform. And that's a very socially important factor. And I'll come back to that. That's, in fact, today is maybe the most important social issue which Medvedev will face. I will not discuss the banks, but in principle, banking situation during these years changed completely. We still have, how it's said here, banking penetration weaker than Kazakhstan and Ukraine, and still we have 1,000 banks, but not 4,000. But anyway, you can see the figures that assets as percentage of GDP increased dramatically from 34 to 63%, and loans, investment based on loans, on banking loans, increased from 3 to 11%. So de facto, during this year, banking reform took place, and Russian banks now are normal, I wouldn't say completely Western type banks, but it's banks, and the mortgage market just started, and it's only 2.3% of GDP was in the level in the end of 2007. It's only, mortgage per capita is only $211, with the average salary of 550. So that's, we are not afraid of all the types of crises you had here, because it still doesn't exist. But we can be sure that it started, it will be developed, and in 5 years' time, we'll have a normal mortgage market as well as we had everything else. That was all good news. And all this good news mainly were connected with overall macroeconomic situation, that's number one, and the level of living of majority of people, number two. Now, what are the main problems and challenges we still might face, which Mr. Medvedev might face? First of all, this budget policy. You can see on the right picture that, in fact, Russia now, after all these years with all of high oil prices, used to live with very high expenditures. In fact, today Russian expanded government collect even more than they did before. I had a very long discussion with our Minister of Finance Kudrin in 2000, and his goal was to decrease tax burden at least 1% a year. So to come to the level of 30%, to collect about 30% of GDP in the end of in the year 2008. Contrary to that, they now collect more than before, and that's 40% of GDP is now in the expanded government hands. So that's a big surplus, so they spend 34%, but still that's a huge figure. And in fact, the main challenge within these figures is that if with the current demographic trend, without serious pension reform, government will spend in 5 years, they will likely increase pension expenditures for around 3% of GDP additionally. De facto, if today's situation stays as it stays, and oil price stays at about $100, not even 120 or 200, a ratio between salary, average pension will go below 20% soon enough. And that's a very dangerous story. That's put a very strong pressure. So de facto, Medvedev still face absolute immediate need to do something with the budget to cut expenses. At the same time, to cut it with this pressure is difficult. Plus, there are certain sectors as healthcare, But de facto already there was a serious cut. Today in Russia, share of healthcare and GDP is below 3%, below 3% of the budget. And that's, I think, is a very low figure. So de facto, he will have to do something with the budget. And that's a fragile story because all this budget revenues mainly based, I will tell it later on oil money, of course. Pension reform, once again, that's issue number one. 8 years of Putin rule, we discussed pension reform, nothing done. Today, only 2% of Russian population, from this 40% of pensioners, they have some accounts in private pension funds. De facto, non-existent. $350 million, that's all money in private pension funds for the whole country. And all attempts to do something with the last 2 or 3 years were absolutely inefficient. So we need not only economically to promote it, but just mentally to build a system that you have to be responsible for yourself, that you have to think about your future, that you have to think about your savings. And that's a huge challenge without which, I guess, all the budgetary problems of Mr. Medvedev cannot be resolved. We have, of course, banking problems, but that's not as impossible, as important. But anyway, what is the second challenge? That's here in the sign of investment. Russia is, as I told you already, Russia is within the consumption boom. One very dangerous sign of this consumption boom is very high expectations. When you live 10% better every year for 8 years, you expect that you will live 10% better in next year to come. Today, Russians don't save. In fact, average Russian household save an average during Putin's year 11% of their annual income. 11%. So de facto, everything to be spent. Inflation, of course, and negative interest rate is an additional, very strong additional argument to spend everything today, not to put it to the banks. What we have now, what the picture we can see now, that 11% is the only ratio. It was a little bit more, it's around 15% last year as an exemption, but again, it's still low figure. And the fact that this 15%, let's take 12%, which that's all savings, one third of that is put into ruble cash in case, and again, under mattresses, very old tradition. One-third banking deposits with negative real interest rate, and one-third for real estate market. Again, for Russians today, the most secure investment mentally is apartments. So people buy apartments. That's a major reason why still the prices for properties is going up, because that's mainly used just we have many people who just buy apartments in case. So that's definitely a bubble, and something happens, the first thing you'll start to do, you sell it. But today, that's how it is. And in fact, with this consumption pattern, in fact, it's very difficult to guarantee further growth. I mentioned already that Putin was not unlucky, not only with the oil price, but also with the 50% emptiness of the oil facilities. 50% of industry which he inherited from the Soviet Union was not used. So de facto, you just can take it in. Now, in fact, 90% is already used, and we need crucially to increase investment in order to go further on. And what we can see that, unfortunately, all this growth in all this money which we spend, they were spent, again, once again, on consumption, stabilization fund, foreign debt, on import. Serious restructuring inside the country didn't take place. Any restructuring in the country didn't take place. And growth of import is unbelievable. In fact, first quarter, annually, we have export growth average last 3 years, 6% a year. It was 12% a year before. Now export is growing 6% a year in fixed price. Export growth first quarter of this year to first quarter of previous year is 42%. So de facto, it's going like that. So the country is just spending its money. And that's a very, very dangerous and not very productive tendency. We still didn't have a lot of discussion about deprivatization, but or the lack of privatization and the increasing of state control. But that's all truth. But the main signals of that is there was no reforms done, except Rao, yes, where Alpha Bank was one of consultants, but Gazprom and Gazprom Russian railroads, cost subsidization is again at the level of 3% of GDP, and the fact energy efficiency as low as it was before, de facto no reforms took place in these major areas. And we can be sure that more state takes under its own control, less reform will take place. And in fact, I remember very well all discussions about cutting costs, to cut costs in railroads, and there's no discussions. The only thing, they have a lot of money, CapEx is going up permanently. And in fact, when we discuss, I mentioned that we have 21% growth of investment. Huge part of this investment came from the state monopolies, in fact. Railroads, railways, and so on and so forth. And that's, of course, again, on the agenda. And the last thing, which again is very important, level of state bureaucracy. You can see here that public sector still employs 60% of the population, and the number of state bureaucrats increased at least 25% since year 2000. You can see very clear signs on that. When you go to any ministry, to any state organization, number of babushkas going around with something in their hands, that's going up every day, you can see. You can see in the Kremlin, with all big corridors now sitting ladies for something, just sitting ladies, just because that's just that's how it is. That was very, again, very Soviet type style, and that's number, the share of state bureaucrats in population is bigger than in the Soviet Union now. And something has to be done with that, for sure. When I sent my presentation here initially, I had a comment from Fred to comment on oil. Overall, of course, oil is the main reason for all this growth and all this macroeconomic stability. But to be frank, without Mr. Putin, who deeply believes that nobody can spend efficiently money, and he thinks that money to be given will be stolen, they better keep them in the stabilization fund, all this money would have been spent. So macroeconomically, definitely, that was a success based on, of course, of oil price. You can see that steel and Urals potential prices grows during these years from 95 till 2007, that's all known. You can see also that in 95, fuels gave 37% to export. Now they give how much? 61, as far as I remember. 50% of budget revenues today is commodities. So of course that's all based on oil. That's no question basically on that. But in the same time, again, due to very tough tax regime and the production of oil didn't go up, it's flat now. And gas, I guess it's negative, it's open, it's top state secrets, we don't know, in fact, proper figures. But anyway, in the latest months, during last year, we can see that de facto something has to be done with the oil sector in order to support growth based on oil. Today's share of oil in budget, when in export is a different story, in budget also because it's prices, but in physical terms, the share of fuels and commodities will go down, not up. So this resource grows based on oil, somehow not anymore there, at least not on the scale it was there before. Now I come to conclusions. Russia has now extremely stable macroeconomic situation. That's definitely true. At the same time, we can also be sure that all these possibilities which we had during these years due to high oil price and international and cheap international capital also was a very important factor, in fact, wasn't unused. And the gap we used to say, BRIC, Brazil, Russia, India, and China, you can see that the gap between Russia and Brazil on the one hand and China and India on the other has widened in the past several years. The same as the gap between Russia in absolute terms and United States, for example. So it's optimistic picture on the one hand, but definitely you can see that the gap with our major, I would say, rivals and competitors are going up, not down. We also see that Russia is still not a liberal country. President Medvedev mentioned yesterday that his first goal would be to provide more freedom to economy and to civil society, but today economy is as regulated as it was 8 years ago. De facto, a very clear sign of that is that, again, share of small and medium-sized enterprise is very low. It's about 15% again, and then going up. Social and pension reforms are a must, just because, again, budget will not be able to survive with this demographic situation anymore. and something has to be done, and pension reform is definitely a very painful thing. And if this is not done, I think that, again, popularity of a new leader might be in risk. And what is the most important, I would say, that the growth paradigm should shift, how it's said here, from consumption to investment-driven. Russia needs crucially increased investment. We are 2 times below China now in GDP terms. As we invest up to 15% of GDP, Russia, China's figure is above 30%, and Russia is below everybody. For that, inflation, of course, is a very important, it's a very important story. With high inflation, to provide investment is very difficult. And also, foreign investment, FDI outside food sector is flat. It's about 1% of GDP. And 70% of foreign direct investment to Russia comes from 2 countries, Netherlands and Cyprus. That's, and that's, of course, that's Russian money, which left and then coming back. So this issue of investment and social issue and deregulation, I would think, is a priority. I believe that we have everything except we have everything in the hands of Mr. Medvedev to deal with these issues. It's only political will, and but I'm very much afraid that with oil prices on to a level of 200, it's very difficult to implement reform. Somebody will have to do it. Hopefully, it will be Mr. Medvedev who arrange all these reforms in the nearest future. Thank you.